Welcome back, companions. This is chapter 5 of my book, Phaethon's Legacy. If you want to start from the beginning, check the annotated card at the top right. If you want a reminder of what happened last chapter, check on the description box down below. Let's get started, shall we? Eliza Apophis stood alone in the corporate gym with her arms outstretched, eyes closed, and visualized her routine through every movement on the uneven bars. Her eyes snapped open as she leapt to grasp the low bar, a small chalk cloud puffing from her hands. After gaining momentum, she rotated through the air and caught the high bar. She swung herself up and remained still with her feet pointed at the ceiling. Eliza flexed her legs outward, holding the pose for a moment, then swung around in 3 revolutions before releasing. After spinning twice through the air, she landed on the gym mat, stumbling to one knee. Her eyebrows tightened as she frowned. This was the 7th day she had practiced the routine, but she still couldn't stick the landing. Closing her eyes, she visualized the successful landing 3 more times, the scenario playing out in her mind in real time. She had perfected this method of meditation years ago. However, something had changed. She glanced over her shoulder, looking for the presence. It wasn't there. She was alone. She reminded herself that sleep deprivation could cause hallucinations. Compound that with the stress of reoccurring dreams of her dead mother begging for help, it made perfect sense that her mind was playing tricks on her. Eliza moved to the towel rack and methodically removed the protective grip gloves with the wrist bindings, putting on the athletic gear and taking them off in the same way, each time brought a calming peace to her mind. She looked sharply to her left, but nothing was there. With purposeful breath, she washed the chalk off her hands. Her mind wandered at this point, as it often did lately. There was red and white scar tissue, in the shape of a circle, on the backs of both of her hands and on both of her palms. The scarring was the result of implanted flexible discs in each side of her hands, affixed together with titanium bars running between her bones. It had taken 6 weeks for her to regain functional use of her hands, and another 3 months before she could perform gymnastics again. 4 evenly spaced lines of red and white ran from her wrists to her elbows, elbows to shoulders. Her body told the story of dozens of surgeries on every limb to brace bones with titanium, and most joints reinforced with cobalt chrome alloy. She felt the sensation of hands squeezing her shoulders from behind. It was comforting, what she imagined a mother's touch to be. She looked behind her, but of course, there was still no one else in the room. Eliza did her best to push these distractions from her mind. She blotted the water and perspiration off, tied on her shoes, and put on her robe. Normally, she started each day with a cold shower after exercising, but today felt like a warm bath kind of day. Before she made her way to leave, she closed her eyes and visualized the gymnastics routine 3 more times. When she opened her eyes, she saw her father at the entrance, looking at her. Her body tensed up, an automatic reaction which she couldn't control. Every surgical scar seemed to burn with a phantom fever for just a moment. She shook her head slightly. That reaction wasn't appropriate. He surely hadn't decided that more were necessary. No, he promised the previous one would be the last. Well, he had said that he didn't believe she would require any more operations. That wasn't the same as a promise. Emmanuel Apophis was a tall, narrow, bespectacled man wearing his customary glossy lab coat and neutral expression. She walked up to meet him with the same professional neutrality. "Sir?" He spoke with a voice somewhere between reedy and raspy, but as always, with a compelling amount of confidence. Eliza thought she could hear a hint of something unusual today. Excitement. "Eliza, P.U.R.E. Securities has given you an assignment. I knew it was only a matter of time before I could convince them of your worth." He extended a tablet to her, but when she reached for it, he pulled it back with the smallest of frowns. His eyes bore into hers, seeming to rifle through her thoughts. Whatever had given him pause, he seemed to dismiss it, then handed her the device. He said, three rogue elements are within a holding facility in East Chicago, Indiana. The processing will last for 2 days before they are transported to the appropriate government installation. The corporation has accepted my recommendation to place you as the head of the security detail during the processing. They have extended a significant show of trust by placing you into such a position without previous command experience. Since you have so diligently dedicated your time and energies to improving yourself to better safeguard the common welfare, I have no fear that you will certainly defeat the rumors of nepotism. Do you find this acceptable? The mixed compliments warmed Eliza's cheeks, but she paused for a long moment to work through his rhetoric. What have they been charged with? Emmanuel's intentional blink was barely slower than a natural one, but Eliza had come to realize it indicated consideration for the unexpected. She clenched her teeth, immediately sensing that this had been an unwelcomed question. She wouldn't be punished for something like this, but somehow, the thought of disappointing him seemed worse. She didn't know why the thought tightened her breathing, but it did. He once again made unwavering eye contact, looking for any reactions. They have been identified in collusion with groups raiding P.U.R.E. pharmaceutical storage facilities. At best, they are selling medical-grade drugs on the black market. However, we have compelling evidence identifying their operation as the suppliers for terrorist cells which are developing biological weapons. Tiny blinking lights at the edge of her father's glasses made it impossible to forget his habit of recording all interactions. Eliza managed to keep her expression flat and neutral. She had extensive practice burying her emotions. Do you think another cell will try to free them? The tension in his face lessened. The operation did not leave any traces that could be followed. Eliza forced a sardonic tone. Then it sounds like I won't have much to do. Emmanuel gave her a rare smile. Be that as it may, precaution is the route to success. This assignment will be your first step toward proving yourself to the corporation. As a sign of faith, they have given you probationary clearance as a full agent. I believe you understand how important it is for us that P.U.R.E. comes to trust your loyalty and competence beyond the praises I have sung of you. I know you will make me proud, Eliza. Lights flickered across the display screen in his glasses. You will excuse me. I have matters to attend to. Eliza watched her father leave the gymnasium, thinking through the words he had used. His compliments made her feel elated, and that in turn made her feel something unpleasant she could not identify. The man never did or said anything without purposeful intention. Her coursework learning the psychology of leadership, a role he had planned for her, had led her to some upsetting ideas. She feared the possibility that he had been manipulating her. If he was, it was for Eliza's benefit. She knew that. She went back to her rooms, eager to wash off the feeling of the morning. An hour later, Eliza finished getting ready, the final step of which was packing her custom magneto-rheological fluid engagement suit in a travel case. The form-fitting MRF suit would cover her entire body, excluding her head. The helmet, which accompanied the gear of a P.U.R.E. security special agent, was absent. Her unique abilities interfered with the device's electronics, but P.U.R.E. engineers were working on that problem. Not that she needed a helmet for defense, as long as she was aware of the danger before the threat presented itself. Until one could be designed for her, a display visor with earbuds would serve for communication needs. Eliza checked her itinerary schedule on the tablet and made her way to the building's loading dock. One of the building personnel drove her to the monorail, and although Eliza had known the driver's name for a couple years, she was not personally acquainted with her. Her father discouraged the staff from anything resembling a friendship with his daughter. The monorail station was public, but one of the cars was rented out for complete privacy this trip. On the train, Eliza went over the briefing for her first active assignment. Her first mission, to detain and escort those who committed theft and sabotage against the country. With diseases so prevalent, Eliza couldn't understand why people would harm the world's leading supplier of medicine. Could money be the only motivator? As the train reached its standard traveling speed of 200 miles per hour, what should have been anticipation was turning into trepidation. From the time her unique physiology had manifested at 10 years of age, it had been a matter of course that she would work for the corporation. From that day on, Emmanuel had arranged for specialized peer associates to take over her education, none of which ever became closer than impersonal instructors. While she did receive general lessons in math, science, history, and language, the most significant part of her curriculum became tailored to turn her into an agent specialized in countering domestic terrorism. Unprecedented advances in biological engineering had started to become a notable threat in the last two decades. Somewhere, criminals were turning people into weapons. P.U.R.E. obtained government contracts to establish their own genetically enhanced counterterrorism division. Eliza truly knew how important it was to protect the American people from these radicals, but the choice hadn't been hers. How was a 10-year-old girl supposed to understand what agreeing to years of gene therapy and surgical implants would be like? How was she supposed to understand what it meant to be a Homeland Security soldier for the rest of her life? Eliza came out of her transfixing thoughts when she heard a voice in the train car, muffled by the music from her earbuds. She took them out and looked around. Seeing no one in the car with her, she quickly looked back at the window. For a moment, she had been sure there was a hand there. Now, all she saw were cities, hills, and sometimes the ocean, rolling by at strange speeds. She hoped she could get rest tonight after her security shift ended. She hoped that, but thought it very unlikely. Maybe she could find satisfaction in the life chosen for her. Protecting her country was certainly meaningful, and the threat of biological weaponry was very significant. The two decades of international turmoil and war following the Superflare had been devastating. However, from that catastrophe, nations rebuilt themselves. Many new nations formed, settling centuries-long border disputes. In the 30 years which followed the turmoil, a certain kind of peace had settled over the world. The times of war between nations seemed to be in the past. However, what replaced national conflicts was the rise of small, independent, fanatical insurgency groups. They went hand in hand with black market cartels, which were ever present, no matter the state of the world. Crime lords, insurgencies, and terrorists were preferable to wars. However, in another way, they were harder to deal with. They existed unknown to the public and needed to be rooted out. Now, with biological cybernetics on the black market, individual criminals could be as dangerous as small-scale military weapons. Protecting the defenseless civilians of her country mattered a lot to Eliza. How many hundreds of lives could she protect over her lifetime? She would suffer so many more could live normal, happy lives. She just wished she had been given the option to choose this path. Outside the window, she saw the train crossing into the state of New York. Eliza was surprised that she had been lost in thought for about an hour. She decided to focus on the task at hand. Opening the assignment document, she noted that the address line was the code name her father had picked for her, Agent Empyrean. It meant fire from heaven. Picking her agent alias was just one more choice, among countless others, which she had not been allowed to make. Eliza squeezed her eyes shut and made another effort to keep her mind focused. She read the document which detailed her duty as security commander at Morgan Distributions. The end of chapter 5. Make sure to subscribe and leave a like to find out what happens next time. See you then, companions.